Hi, I'm Dr. Emmanuel Aiko. The early signs of a heart attack can vary. The most common include squeezing across the chest, a feeling of unease, and a sense that something just isn't right. It can be easy to dismiss the early signs of a heart attack, as the symptoms don't always feel severe. It's never too early to call 999 and describe your symptoms. Your NHS is here for you.
Well, look at this! Here's the guy here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
What were you doing in that warehouse?
You lied to me. You were at that crash.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Stop pissing me around, Gwen. You're so used to lying and fobbing me off, like the idiot that I obviously am.
Those blokes paying you? Why were you there?
No, I'm asking the questions, all right? I followed you, okay? Yeah. So that bloke, the tall bloke in the coat, you f***ing him or what?
All I ever asked was you trust me.
What? Like you trust me? It's a two-way street, Gwen.
There's stuff you don't understand, Reese.
Oh, of course not. I'm just a big dumb animal, aren't I? I mean, what's so secret you can't even tell your own fiancé, eh? You know, in fact, why are you marrying me, Gwen, eh? What, am I just a habit you can't be asked to break?
No.
Then tell the truth!
All right, my job! The special ops thing, it's a liar cover story.
Thank you! At last! God, what's that taking? About a year? So that's one lie down. How many more have we got to deal with, eh? Is there anything in your life that's actually based on truth?
Us.
Us? Us is crumbling when us is falling to shit.
Do you think I enjoy keeping all this stuff to myself?
Then why did you?
Because I'm trying to protect you! Have you ever stopped to think about that? No. No, because you prefer to blunder in without thinking or looking. Good old ham-fisted Reese's heart. His heart is in the right place, but his brain is a million miles from.
Come on, let's have it all in, shall we? What exactly do I need protecting from?
I catch aliens!
Good news, boppers. The big alert has been called off. It turns out that the early reports were wrong. All wrong. Now, for that group out there that had such a hard time getting home, sorry about that. I guess the only thing we can do is play you a song.
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I just cannot get enough of the TV show Warrior on Sky Max.
Hi, I'm producer Dave. You just reminded me of the film Warriors. Do you remember that film from the 79?
From the 80s, right? From the 80s.
Yeah. You just reminded me of that film. I haven't seen it for ages. Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were going to say you've never seen it before. I was like, what are you talking about?
Of course I've seen it, but it's been ages.
Can you dig it?
Yeah, we had that as a clip ages back, didn't we? Yeah.
I love that. It's got so many bits from it. One bit in particular that I never knew, and I'd been saying it for years before I watched the film, was... there's this song in from 95. It's a rap song. It's a remix of a Craig Mack song, A Flavor in Your Ear. It's got Notorious B.I.G. It's got Craig Mack. I think it's got LL Cool J and Busta Rhymes and a couple of other people. Black Thought, I think, are in it as well. Great song, Flavor in Your Ear remix. Now, it starts with Puff Daddy going, "Bad boys, come out and play," and then the song kicks in. And so I never knew where that came from, right, until sat down watching the Warriors, and then towards the end someone just comes out and just starts going, "Warriors, come out and play." I'm like, you stole that from P. Diddy. And I'm like, well, actually no, it's the other way around. It's like, okay, fair enough. So anyway, Warriors, great film, but that's not It has nothing to do with Warrior. Have you heard of Warrior, the TV series?
No, I haven't, no.
Okay, so
Is it an American sort of like game thing that you play and you get bounced off balls and what have you?
No, you're thinking of American Ninja Warrior. Completely
That as
different.
well.
No, completely different. So it's on one of the title things. It always comes up and says it's based on stories by Bruce Lee, and it is set in. I'm gonna butcher the storyline, obviously. But it's based on. It's set in, if I'm not mistaken, maybe the 19. Was it saying 1920s or the 1890s in America? And I'm going to quickly do a check because I don't want to do it any injustice. So I've got it right here, and it says, oh, there we go. So during the Tong Wars in the late 1800s, so it's set in America in the 1800s, San Francisco to be specific, and it follows Assam. A Chinese immigrant who is fluent in English, but obviously, when the Chinese emigrated to America, a lot of them didn't speak English and so on. But he, well educated, spoke English before he got there and is a massively talented fighter. And it is basically the fact that it's based on stories of Bruce Lee. You can imagine if Bruce Lee was still alive, he would be playing that main character. So just imagine Bruce Lee playing that lead character, right? He's got nunchucks and everything. It's from the makers of Banshee. It's got some of the actors from Banshee. If you remember Banshee, I'm sure I've raved about Banshee. It's one of my top 10 favorite TV shows of all time. It's an amazing show, very visceral in terms of the action, hard-hitting fights, just brilliant, brilliant show. It's in its third season. So anyway, it focuses on this character called Assam, who's looking for his sister, and he is in San Francisco, in Chinatown in San Francisco. And it's essentially in the 1800s when the Chinese are dealing with issues of immigration and trying to settle in. And the Irish are also coming in, and they're dealing with work and so on. And it is ch and so you have gangs that are fighting against each other. It is a great, great show. Obviously, if you're highbrow, you might think, "Eh, I don't want to be seeing the violence and the sex and all that kind of stuff in the show." But it is just so beautifully shot. It's in its third season at the moment. I am binging it. I'm currently on episode 6 of season 3. I hope this show continues. I hope it carries on for years because this is it's a well, maybe not years, maybe 2 more seasons, and then it can rest on. It can just slowly end, knowing that it was one of the best TV shows, 100 best TV shows, whatever.
I'm
But
going
it's
to make a slight fool of myself. Is
gone.
that related to that Daniel Day-Lewis film? That
No, it's not related to any Daniel Day-Lewis. And I know what you which the Daniel Day-Lewis one that you're thinking of is
Is it Gangs of New York or
Gangs
whatever?
of New York. Not related to it at
Or
all.
similar in aspects?
Okay, so you think about
Kind of like the same time.
yes, around the same kind of time, but Gangs of New York is obviously as the title implies, it's set in New York, right? So but it is around the same kind of time. It's dealing with the same kind of issues with gangs in so in, Gangs of New York is set around 1862, right? And it's set in New York, where you have the various gangs that are there in New York. You've got the Irish gang and so on and so forth that's there. So yes, it is in around the same kind of setting, but it's a different part of the country, different set of gangs. But just imagine Gangs of New York as a TV series with martial arts and tons of sex.
Oh,
That
okay, yeah, even better.
Warriors.
Even
Yeah.
better.
So that's the pitch. Thank you for even bringing up Gangs of New York, because that when you talk about visuals, it's just it's very it's beautifully done as well. The costumes are fantastic. For those who are interested in romance stories, there are some romances that are in it, fleeting, but they're still there. It's a great show. Great, great show. Anyway, if you
So
haven't,
what channel is that on?
it's on Sky Max. So if you've got a Sky package, you can see it. It's also those of you who have HBO can also see it on HBO, maybe HBO Max. And I think think Cinemax. I think it's a Cinemax production. So if you have those channels, go check it out. It's great. It is a fantastic TV show. I can't stop raving about it. It's great. I'm binging the episodes and I can just keep going and going and just ranting about it. But I'll stop with my ranting. Producer Dave, what have you been watching recently?
To be quite honest, I have not been watching that much in the way of TV. I mean, the TV's been on, but it's usually something that I've seen before because it's something I can quickly dip in and out of. Nothing new, really, to be quite honest.
Okay, there's sort of nothing because are you too busy? It's stopping you from watching TV shows or focusing on TV. It makes me feel bad because that's all I do. I just watch TV and videos and stuff.
It's not so much that I'm too busy, it's just that when you can't be bothered to concentrate on something new. It's, for instance, I have been wandering through really slowly a couple of series on Apple TV. Which ones have I been wandering through? Because I've seen Ted Lasso several times
Got it.
because I'm familiar with that, comfortable with that and stuff like that. Then you've got For All Mankind, and I've been one. You have to sit down and focus on that.
Yes,
You really do have to sit down and focus on that because if you miss a bit, you sort of like you miss quite. You could be missing quite a chunk. So, I've been going through that slowly, but only when the mood takes me. It's not when I'm kind of like here, there, and everywhere and
you
focused.
know what?
When I'm so like my concentration is wandering or whatever. So yeah.
You know what? Funnily enough, because my brain, obviously it's age and it's all the stuff that I've been watching basically put holes in my memory. I was wondering recently, I was like, I'm sure I've watched a whole bunch of TV shows. And that's one, I know you're anti binge watching stuff. One of the downsides to binge watching stuff is because you've watched the entire thing and you move on to something else, you forget what it is that you watched. But now that you've mentioned Apple TV, that flooded my memory with a lot of the TV shows I've watched. So I haven't seen For All Mankind yet. However, I did binge Shrinking, which is from the creators of Ted Lasso. Brett Goldstein is one of the creators and writers. He's Roy Kent from Ted Lasso. He's written on Shrinking. It's got I can't remember his name, the guy that's from Forgetting Sarah Marshall. He's from How I Met Your Mother. I can't remember. He's an actor. He's in it. He's the main character. But
Hang on, isn't that the one with what's his name? Indiana Jones in
Harrison
it.
Ford.
Yeah,
Har
Harrison
yes,
Ford.
Harrison Ford's in it as well. It's a great show. Again, similar to Ted Lasso, with the very subtle humor, the very gentle humor. But it's more about this time. It's not about football. This time, it's more about psychiatry, if you will. It's about people who are going to psychiatrists, and the main characters are three main psychiatrists in this practice, and the main one. This is no spoiler. They say it in the very first episode. He's lost his wife. And she died maybe a year before the events of the show, and it's basically him coming to terms with it, even though it's been a year, and so on, and the impact of all the friends and family and so on. It's good. The writing is very, very good. Still, Ted Lasso for me is higher than that one, but it's there. Also, another show on Apple TV that I've watched is that I binged.
Silo?
Yes, sorry.
Silo.
No, I did Silo ages ago.
Yes, I know.
Yes,
That's why I mentioned it.
we didn't talk about that. That was ages ago. It's like it was that feels like years ago.
Oh,
It was a
gosh.
great show. It's a great show. I can't wait for season two to come out so I can watch it. But it didn't grip me as well as some of the other mystery kind of stuff that I've watched. But it's good. It's very well acted. One thing I think I said this the last time we spoke. One thing I really liked about it is if you don't know the story, if you haven't read the books and you don't know the story, or you haven't read the synopsis or whatever, with the actors, the level of the caliber of actors that are brought in, it's just you have no idea who's going to survive because you'll think one person's the main character and then they kill off that person and they bring in another person and they kill off that person and then you think, oh well, it's this person all along and they kill off
Yeah, I
that
remember
person.
that conversation now, yeah.
And it's like, what the hell is going on? It's like, who let Jake, what's his name? The guy that did Game of Thrones, not R.R. Tolkien, what's his name? The one who did, because it's Tolkien and, oh, I can't remember his name. The guy who
Martin.
created, yes, who let the creator of Game of Thrones in on this project? Because that's what he's doing, he's just massacring everybody. But yeah, so Silo was good. But the other one I watched on Apple TV is The After Party. And the After Party, it follows the same. It's a mystery, right? It's like a detective mystery where the first season, again, great character actors, great actors, comedic actors in it. Your man Sam Richardson from our favorite villain from Ted Lasso, right? He's the lead character in it, right? So he's in it as well. He's great. So the first season follows these friends who go to this they go to their high school reunion, and one of the group is this successful music star played by Franco, not James Franco, but the brother, and he gets killed in the very first episode. And so the entire TV sorry, the entire series season is about them investigating who killed the guy, and there's a time crunch. It also has to be in one night. So each episode, they're interviewing a character, and you're seeing that night from the perspective of that character, and it goes through. It's a great show. They do that in the first season. Same thing in the second season. The same format. It's got Tiffany Haddish in it as well. She's the investigator that's doing it. It's great. It's a good show. It's a good show. So it's on Apple TV. Anyway, we could keep ranting about all the stuff that we've been watching, but let's move on. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Ako.
I'm producer Dave.
And we've done a whole bunch of chat about some of the stuff that we've been watching, but let's move on to some of the other stuff that we'll be talking about. In the spotlight section, we're going to be talking to Tom Price, actor from Torchwood and a number of other TV shows that you've seen him. A great comedic actor. He has a podcast called My Mate Bought a Toaster, which is it's a great podcast. We're going to talk a lot about it during the spotlight section when we jump into that bit. But before we get to that, let's jump into film and TV news. So, in our film and TV news this week, producer Dave and I, we came across a couple of articles from The Guardian, which talked about the title of one of the episodes, one of the articles was stated, "The Great Cancellation: Why Mega Bucks TV Shows Are Vanishing Without a Trace." At the same time, another article was focusing on movies, which is "The Batgirl You'll Never See: Why Some Films Disappear Forever." So, long and short of it, these two articles were basically talking about how big studios like Warner Brothers and Netflix and Disney Plus are spending a lot of money in huge, on huge budget TV shows and films, just to either shelve or just throw away the projects that they're working. For example, the Batgirl movie. That movie cost 90 million. If you've never heard of this, there's a Batgirl movie that was made last year, as in it was completed last year. The plan was that it was going to be released in 2022. It had Michael Keaton coming back as Batman in the Batgirl by Warner Brothers, and it cost 90 million to make. It had been completed and just got shelved, not even streamed on HBO Max or Max, as they're calling it, just shelved completely. And one of the reasons, there's a lot of speculation as to why it's been shelved. The main theory that's going on at the moment is that it was shelved for tax purposes. So, they're writing it off as a tax loss, if you will. Same thing with the article on TV shows. So it the article started off, the article was written by the article on in The Guardian by Stuart Heritage. It's on The Guardian, "The Great Cancellation: Why Mega Bucks TV Shows Are Vanishing Without a Trace." The article starts off talking about this TV show called Nautilus, which was done by Disney Plus. And it goes on to describe this massive production that was done in Queensland. It injected 96 million into the local economy by getting hundreds of crew and hundreds of extras, and they made the TV series, except, as it says, nobody's going to see it, because even though it's already been made, completed, Disney Plus have decided not to stream it. So, producer Dave, you read these articles as well, right? What did you get as the reason for these shows, according to these articles, these shows and these films not being released?
Well, from what I see, it's more of a tax thing than anything else. I couldn't believe that they would spend £96 million or dollars on a show just not to show it. It's a bit cynical, because they actually also say right at the end, well, they're looking for a new home for it, but that means someone else is going to have to shut out for it, and they get their money back anyway. So it's a great big tax write-off. I just think, you know, all those creatives who put heart and soul into it are now going to go away to get nothing from it, if you see it. No acclaim, yeah. No criticism, nothing. Even the criticism would be positive for them, because at least it would have been shown and they could have taken some lessons from it. They're not going to get any of that, to be quite honest. No praise, no criticism, nothing, no constructive criticism. And at the end of the day, the people who are going to lose are the people who are paying for it. If you have Disney Plus, you're actually paying for things like that.
Yeah.
And at the moment, you've got a writer's strike as well. Yes. So they're throwing away shows that have already been completed. What are they going to show in their place? They're not making anything right now. So this is the perfect time for them to wheel that out. But no, they're going to tax write it off and maybe palm it onto someone else.
Yeah, it's crazy. You're right. It's very disheartening. On the one hand, it's very disheartening that that is something they could do, where they would take the hard work of all of the creators, the writers, the crew, the extras, the staff, you know, everybody would put in all their effort into getting that project. It'd take months, sometimes even years, to get those projects done, and then just shelve it. And it, on the flip side as well, just as you mentioned it, the WGA, the Writers Guild of America, and the SGA, Screen Actors Guild, they're both, those two unions are currently on strike because of bad faith deals done by production companies and studios, where they're not paying their writers enough, they're not paying the actors, and in fact the actors are striking in solidarity with the writers. And I know it's not just about how much they're being paid, because they're not being paid a living wage. That's one of the complaints. A lot of people are trying to diminish what they're striking about, but the key things are the wages that are being paid to the writers, especially on streaming services, where those streaming services and those companies will gladly take the projects and carry on streaming it and getting all the revenues, like Netflix, for example, that they don't show their numbers. So that becomes a problem, because the writers and the creators of those shows don't actually get to see how well their projects are doing. So they're not getting paid for that, as well as the fact that there are clauses that are being brought in by producers and studios where they want to start using AI to write scripts and get stories, where all AI is doing is just stealing from other writers who've done their stuff. So writers aren't getting paid because it's going through AI, and so they're complaining about this. So juxtapose these two situations that are happening, where the writers and the Screen Actors Guild are striking because the studios are not investing enough in them and in their creativity. And on the flip side, when they are spending massive amounts on projects like that, they're just shelving it or writing it off. It boggles the mind. Obviously, you know, we're not in any position to be able to understand or make any kind of changes, but reading that article was an eye-opener. I had heard about the whole Batman, well, not Batman, but the Batgirl project being shelved. But reading the article just basically opened my eyes to the fact that it seems to be a regular occurrence that is happening with these studios. And it can be disheartening for someone who gets into the business, a very tough business to get into in the first place, to get your project to that point where you see it completed and all you're expecting is, okay, in the next 6 months, people are going to be watching this and people will see all that hard work. And then to hear, nah, it'll never be shown. Nobody will ever see it because they've decided to write it off. It's anyway.
I think what's a bit more disheartening is that the decision's not being made by people who've got a creative bone in their body. It's more being made by accountants and the money men who are just looking at a balance sheet and thinking, we've spent 96 million on this, let's recoup by cancelling it and using it as a tax write-off. And that, I believe, is the most disheartening thing of the lot, that creatives are not in control of their own destiny. It's the accountants and the other money men, or money people, should I say, who are in control. And that is the most disheartening.
Yeah, you know, we'll keep listening, keep our ears, listening to the news. We'll keep reading news and try to figure out more if there are more theories as to why this is happening, and especially more about the Writers Guild and the Screen Actors Guild, because we were going to talk about that last week's episode, but we didn't get the chance to do that. By next week, we're going to look into it and find out where they're at the moment, because at the moment of this recording, they're at a stalemate. So we'll try and find out what's going on over there. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And this is Spotlight. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm here with actor, writer, a producer, podcaster. You've seen his face, you've heard his voice numerous occasions. His podcast is My Mate Bought a Toaster. Let's get him to introduce himself, and we'll start off. We'll start off with a weird question, which is going to throw him off guard because I haven't asked him this. I didn't prep him before this. Tell us your name and what your favorite memory of working on Torchwood was.
My name is Tom Price, and my favorite Torchwood memory was having a very controlled but enjoyable street fight in Newport as part of the Children of Earth series, where the fight coordinator said, yeah, you'll be fine, don't worry, you won't get hurt, you'll be no problem at all. And then about 30 seconds later, I was cradling a badly damaged elbow. So happy days. You got it. You know what? Blood, sweat, and tears. I'll do anything for Russell T. Davis. That's the top line.
They didn't provide you a stuntman to do your role, or you figured, no, I'll be Tom Cruise. I'll jump in there and get it done.
I think they thought I was the stuntman. They weren't fans of the show, and they thought this guy is such a bad actor. He must be a stuntman. He can't be the real thing. I just threw myself into it. They said the best thing to do is really get stuck in, and then they said everyone else who's fighting has been given some training on how to do the fight, so all you got to do is roll with it. And I was like, okay then. So I just sort of very much did what I did when I played rugby at school, sort of pushed and shoved a bit, and before I knew it, I was in pain. That story of my life, Marcus.
That's okay. Hey, that's, as you said, it's the blood, sweat, and tears that every actor dreams to be able to shed. So and Torchwood being a very fantastic show, a very long time ago. I do remember you in that. I remember seeing you in a number of other things as well. Episodes is one of my favorite TV shows. No, well, they were like top 20 TV shows, and I remember you popping up in there. And you pop up in various comedy shows, especially the improvised ones. Like there's one. It just slips in my mind. Tourist Trap. That's it.
Yeah, of course, the Welsh one. Yeah.
Yes, and so I see your face pop up every now and again. And so as soon as the email came through saying, "Would you like to interview Tom Price?" I was like, "Absolutely, it'd be good to chat to this guy." So the first question I want to ask you, almost the second question I want to ask you, is how did you get into the industry? What was your motivation to get into the industry? How did you start?
So I was just an unbearable show off from the age of about 4 o'clock. From the age of four o'clock, yes. you have those moments where your brain just lets you down. You're like, oh, thanks, brain. Oh, it's one of those days today, is it?
I see. Usually when I'm drinking, yes.
Yeah, well, me too. I mean, come on, it's 11:34, so why not?
Hey, it's cocktail hour somewhere.
Exactly. So I was always wanting to do acting ever since I was a kid. My earliest memories are of watching my older brothers doing plays and thinking, I really want to go and do that. And then it just sort of spiraled. And I really got into watching a lot of comedy when I was a teenager, things like Bottom and Partridge and Blackadder. And then I chose my university based on them going to Edinburgh, because I just really wanted to go to the Edinburgh Festival. And so I went to a great uni that took shows to Edinburgh, and then I did a sketch show at Edinburgh, and then that was it. It was just comedy and acting, and I got spotted by an agent in Edinburgh, and it just sort of snowballed, really. I think the main thing was I wasn't particularly good. I mean, I really wasn't, and I would argue I'm probably still not, but you've got to keep going at these things. You've got to keep doing them. And there was a real moment when I was about 23, 24, and I suddenly worked out how to be on a stage. And I got a lot better. And it just happened, really. It just happened, but it took ages and loads of work and loads of sacrifices, but it just happened.
But most actors say that about themselves. They always say that they're not as good as people may say that they are. So you probably, I don't know about what, if this is something about you yourself. Do you like watching yourself, the TV shows that you've been in? Do you like watching those episodes and seeing yourself in them?
No, not really. I'm very critical. I don't mind watching myself back if it's stuff I've written. So like Tourist Trap, where quite a lot of it was improvised by me. Also brilliant writers behind the scenes on that as well. People like Gareth Gwyn, Ben Partridge, fantastic Welsh writers. And I just like watching that back because I like seeing jokes. So if there's a joke I know I'm about to deliver, then I will like watching that back. But if I'm watching myself in a performance in something like in Victoria, I was in Victoria for a couple of seasons, and you're such a small cog in a giant machine that you think, it gets to you and you're like the triangle player in the orchestra and you're just going, oh God, don't get in the way of the story. Don't get in the way of the story. I think when there's a story to serve, I get very nervous. When there's a joke to serve, I'm very happy.
I see your point. And I do agree with you on the, especially with improvised comedy as well. If it's something that you've improvised and you know it landed superbly, I'm very proud. I agree with you, because I'm an actor as well. Although it's been a very long time since I've done it. The same thing occurs. I hate watching myself in scripted stuff because when I watch it, I'm like, oh, just passing. I was just doing the scene. I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. But if it was a bit where it's like maybe it was improvised or it was off the cuff and it landed spectacularly, I love watching that over and over again because it's like, this is good. This shows that you're funny. So it's like,
yeah. I think it's because I don't know, maybe we all feel less like I trust my comedy bone as a viewer. So if I'm watching myself, I know I've got a joke right, and I know I'm pretty good at getting those right. Whereas, like I say, with a storyline where, you know, I need to look tired, upset, but tense, or whatever those notes are for this moment, and I will watch it and go, I don't know if I've done that here. Have I done that here? I don't know. And it's that doubt which sows madness. Whereas with comedy, I go, yeah, that's funny. And it's just a nice feeling.
That's excellent. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco, and we're speaking with actor, writer, podcaster, comedian Tom Price, who is he's got his podcast, which we're going to be talking about in a couple of minutes, so I will dive into that, which is the name of your podcast. Hold on, I have it right here. It's My Mate Bought a Toaster, which is interesting. I have listened to one episode, but I want to get your take on it, just because we're a film and movie film and TV radio show. I want to ask you, what is your favorite film that you may have seen on Amazon? Because your podcast is about Amazon. What's your favorite film that you've seen on Amazon? Not necessarily go to the cinema, but on Amazon, maybe Amazon Prime.
Oh, this is a great shout. So good films that are on Amazon Prime at the moment. Am I allowed to look at my
absolutely
feel my free machine?
In fact, do that. It's like, because if you regularly watch it on there, when you pop up on Amazon Prime, the first thing that pops up, film or TV show that pops up on your Amazon Prime account, what is it? This is where it gets really embarrassing because you come out and say something. Exactly.
Well, you're basically doing to me what I do to people on my podcast. So now I know what it feels like, because the first thing that comes up for me is Johnny English, included with
it's Rowan Atkinson.
I mean, come on, the guy is a comedy genius, right? I mean, it's fantastic.
Won't knock Rowan Atkinson at all.
No, my God, he's amazing. I adore him. So if I look at all the films that are up on Amazon Prime at the moment, and it is amazing, isn't it? Here he is padding. It is amazing, though, how many there are. that you can just, with Amazon Prime, you can just watch. They're just ready and waiting for you.
It's sort of, I mean, compare that with Netflix, for example. You get, because I used to prefer Netflix. However, with Netflix, you get some of the material, which is obviously, you know, it's made by Netflix, so the quality may be different. Whereas Amazon Prime tend to have more of a wider reach because you know, they don't have to have an exclusive deal with anyone else like Netflix would. So that you tend to get more a broad appeal. But you also get to see some very obscure, unique films on Amazon Prime as well.
You've got to take the dive, right? You've got to just go on then and throw yourself into it.
Yeah.
So mine is, I mean, this might be a bit of a cheat, to be honest, Marcus, because I bought it, but I think it is also on Amazon Prime. But I bought it years ago, and I watch it every Christmas Eve.
Do you say Die Hard?
So, I mean, obviously, right? It's Christmas Eve.
Are we going to dive into the conversation, the Die Hard, is it a Christmas movie?
Oh my God, that is the equivalent of, like, do you say scone or scone? That is the radio equivalent of scone or scone. No, it's not Die Hard. This is weird. And I got my kids to watch it with me for the first time this last Christmas, just gone. Contact.
The Jodie Foster, Matthew McConaughey film.
Obsessed with it.
It's a good film. It's a good film. I saw it a long time ago. I've never got my kids to watch it. But that's because my kid went through a phase where he got scared of anything that was space related.
Would not end well in that case. this is not a good idea. You're better off sticking to Jaws, mate. Jaws.
He's annoyed me recently, so I might get him back and say, hey, do you want to watch this film? It's very nice. It's got James Woods in it.
Being a baddie. It's based on, it's like a Carl Sagan thing. It's based on his novel, which I recently read and was, it really is true to the book. And I love it because I love and not really spoilers here, although maybe spoilers here, the idea that from space, from deepest space comes the sort of flat pack manual, how to build yourself some strange device. And it feels fantastical. And this is what's so good about all good sci-fi should have this. Strangely feasible. The best sci-fi, you think, that's one news moment away. There is every chance that one day we might get a signal from space. There's every chance it might happen.
That's true. You're right. There has to be an element of it being slightly feasible, because then it sort of, you can't just shake it off as being pure sci-fi. If it's something that's extremely fantastical that you can just blink things with your mind, you're like, let's just switch off and watch this. But if it's something that you can say, actually, somebody went into their kitchen and they got all these household appliances and they put it together. Yeah. And just because this one extra thing that they had, they now have a time machine that they can make and go back in time. Immediately, you're locked into that.
It's great. And it's like, it's the same as something I'm really enjoying at the moment on Apple TV is For All Mankind, which is just magnificent.
Is that the one with, your man, Harris? Jared Harris?
Yeah, so it's basically the story of 1969, but the Russians get to the moon first.
Okay.
So that's your starting point. And it's like, that's where it leaves fact behind, and it goes just a tiny bit counterfactual. Well, if that happened, the Americans would have, you know, they'd have doubled down. They'd have invested more to try and build the next, sort of station on the moon, and they would have invested more. And so it pursues that thought, and suddenly human history, but again, by carefully thought out increments, human history takes a totally different direction. It's totally feasible, and it's fascinating. And it's the same thing where you're just going, we're nearly at that point. I mean, sadly, that hasn't happened, and real life is actually really humdrum and a bit depressing. But hey, this is what you could have won. So it's enjoyable for that.
You know what? That is on my list of things to watch, because somebody recommended to me. But it was a choice between that one and another one, which is on Apple TV, which is Silo, which is...
Have you watched it then?
I have. I'm waiting for the finale, which is this week.
So those are based on, what's his name? Hugh Howey's books?
I don't remember the name of the author, but yes, it's based on books, yes.
Yeah, I read those. They came out years ago. He self-published those novels. And it was just a great concept that once every however long it is, I'm sure this is still in a TV show, someone's got to go out and clean the camera. They're living in a silo. They're using a camera to look out on the wasteland. And every now and again, someone's got to go and wipe some dust off. Guys, could we get a windscreen wiper? No, we have to have a human sacrifice.
Yes, because obviously the earth, the outside is extremely toxic, and you know that when somebody steps out, you only have minutes before you die. So it's essentially you go and you clean the camera so people can stare and watch at your dead body just lying in the corner.
I think that is how most men think of household chores. It's like, oh God, it's my one time I'm going to do it. I'm going to change the salt in the dishwasher, but I will die.
I said I was going to do it 6 months ago. Just
Yeah.
stop bothering me about it. It'll get done
Exactly.
soon. Excellent. So, Tom Price, let's talk about your podcast, My Mate Bought a Toaster. What is it all about?
So, My Mate Bought a Toaster is a pretty simple idea. We get on a bunch of comedians and celebrities, and somehow, by hook or by crook, I persuade them to give me the login to their Amazon account. I then log into their Amazon account, and we go right back to the start of their Amazon journey. And for a lot of people now, that begins around 2000, 2001, people started using Amazon. So you can open it up, and by seeing what you bought, which you have forgotten about, because it's all still on there, everything you've ever bought is still on there. You can trace your life, and it is essentially a autobiography because you have not put any filters up. You have not lied. You have not put spin on this. This is not a book you have carefully polished. You can't control the optics. You have to be honest about why you bought often very humdrum things. And as a result, as we've discovered over the 100 plus episodes, you find your way into whole new conversations. And a thing that guests often say on the show, which gives me such a thrill, is, I've done loads of shows and I've never talked about this. And that happens again and again because it's pure honesty. You can't hide from what you buy says about you.
Of course. I mean, you and nobody ever wants to see their browser history or have anybody else see their browser history. And I guess the same thing is with Amazon with your Amazon shopping app, right? So you could pick it. And as you said, you know, the whole thing kicked off from 2021, you know, pandemic when that happened, where basically you can't go to the shops. Obviously, everyone's going on Amazon and buying a whole bunch of stuff. So what is the one thing that if in all the episodes that you've done, that somebody you've looked at the Amazon shopping list, and let's go with first of all the thing that made you laugh the most, and then we'll come back to the thing that shocked you the most. So let's go with what
Oh,
made you
wow.
laugh the most.
What made me laugh the most? Probably still Jade Adams buying a kayak.
Wow, from Amazon, okay.
She bought 600 quid's worth of boat on Amazon. I just made me laugh a lot for a long time.
Does she use it, or is it just decorating the house?
It was a present, actually. It was a
Oh, fair enough.
present.
Okay.
And it was a present for her at the time of the half. And I just love the idea of her getting it for him out of nowhere. Here you are, mate. Kayak, help yourself, get in there. Come on, let's put you out on the Avon. Off you go. And you know, just putting this guy in a boat. Cheers, mate. And him will go, oh, thanks. I never wanted one of these. I don't know
Did
why I'm here.
I tell you I can't swim? It's like
Yeah, exactly.
that's why no longer her partner. So
You'll be fine. Don't let the Tories see you. They'll send you home.
yes.
It's it is just the pure joy of that moment. And when I told her I'd seen it, she laughed and laughed because she just had never really told anyone about it. She had a great story around it. And again, it was just that thing of pure spontaneity. That's what Amazon's so good for, because I think a lot of people always say, oh, you should do this with I don't know, eBay or with X, Y, and Z, or with what I buy on Argos. And I'm like, yeah, sure. But the thing about Amazon is you can 1 minute you can be buying pickles and the next minute you can be buying a parrot. Like, it is utterly random what you can get on there, and that gives the show its sort of drive.
You're right. And with eBay's okay. So with eBay and the Argos examples, with Argos is a specific thing you're going on to Argos to go and buy. So with that specificity comes a little bit of sense. Amazon, on the other hand, is the sense that you're browsing most of the time because you're on there and something catches your eye and you're like, oh, I just want to see how much this costs on Amazon. You never go on to eBay to go and see how much it costs. You go on to
No.
Amazon to see what it costs. And then you're like, oh, there's a cheap one going, and you buy it. And that happens. And it's so easy to do that. And
Yeah,
with
every time.
eBay, not many people use eBay these days. Plus, when you're going on eBay, there's a whole case of you might see something that's weird that you try to bid on, but you get outbid, which means that you didn't buy it. And so that becomes a problem. Amazon, on the other hand, there's no bidding process. When you see it, that lizard brain part of you just says, I want this thing. And you buy it. And then 3 weeks later, it gets delivered. And you're like, when What was I drinking that made me buy a telescopic lens? And then
exactly.
you can, and it's there. So yeah, I get it. So I asked you about what was the funniest thing you've seen. What about the most shocking purchase that you have seen?
The most shocking purchase. I mean, how do you mean in terms of like, in terms of being horrified?
In terms of when you saw it on the person's app, your immediate instinct was to go, I'm going to shut this down and we're not going to have this. We're not going to carry on with this conversation. We're just going to pretend like this never happened.
Yeah. So recently Ed Byrne came on and he bought a pen knife, which has got every single attachment that the Victorinox pen knife company have ever made. And it is about a foot wide and it costs £550 and he bought two.
Wow.
Yeah. That shocked me. And that was a real like, why did you, but there's endless examples of people just buying stuff where you just go, what on earth? Why did you, Julian Clary buying hundreds of doorstops? And I was like, mate, are you very aggressive about your drafts?
Do you just really want to hold one particular door shut?
Yeah, exactly. What is going on there? How many doors have you got, Clary? Great explanation to that, by the way, which you can find out if you listen to the show. It's brilliant. There's just like Dom Jolly came on and he bought something like, I think it was about 500 meters of Ethernet cable. And it was a beautiful story around why he bought that. And it defined a really clear moment in his life. Jake, I could go on for ages about these, Marcus. Jake Yap came on and there was a moment where he bought an auto cue machine, which is the thing he used to first break through and get some really big accolades and his first leap into comedy. So often you'll see the thing someone bought to help them make a big next step in their life. There's loads and loads and loads of these. I think Alex Horn, the most shocking one was Alex Horn bought Mein Kampf.
wow.
Yeah, I mean, really, Alex should have a right of reply. But if you listen to the episode, you'll hear Alex saying, what a great read it is. I don't want to put any, you know, bad vibes about Alex Horn out there. But
you see, that is the example that I would have said, had I just seen it in the app, I would have just closed the app down. I would have just had it in the back of his phone and just gone, thank you. We're going to end the episode here. Thanks for coming. And don't bother me with your calls anymore. And just slowly move away from him.
There was a very, very, as I'm sure you'd expect, a very innocent reason why he bought that. Not that hard to say innocent reason, but there was a very clear and explicable reason why he bought that, which you'll hear if you listen to the episode.
It always starts as innocent and then it is.
That's how it starts.
The podcast is My Mate Bought a Toaster. You can get it. Yeah, so it's the access, people can get onto it. Can they listen to it through podcasts, through Spotify, through YouTube? How can they get a hold of the podcast?
Yeah, everything you've just said, basically, you can listen to it on all your podcast apps. Also, the last few episodes are now on YouTube. We started filming them, so you can see Tom Davis, who was fabulous, actually, talking about, well, we had a good 10-minute chat about back hair, which was enjoyable. So Tom Davis is up on YouTube, and that is youtube.com/@mymatebought a toaster, all one word. We're on all the socials as Toaster Pod, and you can see clips and lists of things people have bought and all our different guests.
So I'm going to ask you, since you get to ask all of those people, and I know I can't grab your phone to check what your purchase is. So as you have your phone on you, would you like to do that? Would you like to just do a quick spin and pick one item that is on your Amazon shopping list?
So I'm going to go into it. Right. Okay, fine. Oh, I wish it is quite weird. I did do it a couple of years ago. I did it myself. But the thing is, time passes, right? And that's like 2 or 3 years ago. So there's a whole new load of stuff. Actually, I can tell you that.
Is this where you see that you've also purchased Mein Kampf?
Yeah. this one's signed. I can tell you, I mean, this really does sum up my life. Bloody hell. Delivered on Monday was DIY insect repellent netting to put around your windows. So essentially, it's been 20 years now of me being with my wife. And every time I open a window in the summer, no matter how hot it is or how badly we need a draft, she goes, close the window, because a fly will come in, or a wasp will come in, or a bee will come in, or a man will come in, close the window. So I said, there's not much I can do about a man breaking in, but I will put up some netting. It's taken me 20 years, and I finally have bought this netting where you cut with scissors and you make the shape of the gap in the window. You stick it up with Velcro. It's really good. There's about 6 windows we regularly have open to get a draft in the house. I did one. It worked really well. And that's it.
Wow, okay. So quite a sensible purchase. I mean, when you started saying mosquito netting, I was thinking, do you tend to go camping? But that's the thing. Everything, when you go onto your Amazon purchase, there's always a reason for it. Although whether I'm sure you skipped past a number of things that you said, yeah, I'm not going to mention this, I'm not going to mention this, I'm not going to mention this, and then it
You'd
got to
be
that one.
surprised when I go, in terms of, what I've got. Obviously, I would never tell you those things. God, I don't know why people do my show, but you'd be surprised how, first of all, how willing people are to talk about stuff. And actually, the best items are not ones that are necessarily rude or smutty, of which there have been not many at all. The best items are the most mundane things. So it's Jade Adams buying a potato masher. It's things like the doorstops. It's Olivia Lee buying 12 carbon monoxide alarms. It's the little details of the minor things that bring out the big life stories we always find on the show.
Excellent. And I highly recommend people go listen to the show. It's called My Mate Bought a Toaster. Tom Price, I want to thank you very much for taking the time to come and talk to us. If people want to follow you on social media, what can they do?
You can find me on Instagram at The Price Tom. You can find me on Twitter at Price Tom. And you can find me at my house. I'm not going to put out my address. I'm just not
Well,
doing
the ones with the mosquito netting that have been cut in a weird shape,
That's
that
right.
looks
Yeah,
exactly what it is.
exactly. It looks like a crime scene tent. That's
Yeah.
basically what we've done. We've built so much netting around it. It's ridiculous.
Excellent. One last question. What's the last movie that you watched at the cinema?
The last movie I watched at the cinema was the new Spider-Man movie, and I'm still furious.
You're furious?
I'm furious because I paid a fortune to take me and my kids to watch it, and it was really long. It was great, and then the ending was a absolute travesty.
Oh, so you're talking into the Spider-Verse
Into the
as opposed to,
Spider-Verse,
oh, got it. Okay,
yeah,
good.
into Spider-Verse. Absolutely incredible. Obviously, there's some great writing, there's some great effects. Deeply immersive. Way too long. When a movie comes along, it's 2.5, 3 hours long. I just think I don't care if it, every single minute's amazing. No, hour and a half, mate. Get better editors, get better writers, learn to tell your story in 90 minutes. Look at Paddington 2. As with everything, look at Paddington 2.
Yes, I can't remember who said that. It's like there's a it was it, the unbearable lightness of unbearable weight of the Nicolas Cage latest film
Oh,
where
yeah.
he's with Pedro Pascal. There's a
Yes.
scene in that where he's I think either Nicolas Cage or Pedro Pascal is listing their top three favorite movies of all time, and Paddington 2 is number one. And
Yeah.
the other person is like, what, dude, how can you put this above things like The Godfather and Schindler's List? And you put that above, and it just cuts quick to them watching at the end, both of them in tears. And it's like, this movie is really great.
It's incredible. The main thing about Paddington 2 is imagine the riches on the cutting room floor. They wanted to make it. I think it's 89 minutes. It was just a rule. We don't go past 90 minutes. There is some incredible stuff, and we'll never see it.
Yeah. Okay. I do agree with you that when the end credits started rolling for Into the Spider-Verse, there was a point where I went, what? Really? You're gonna do this? But sure. Okay.
Also with the kids, it's just like I've got an 8-year-old who's just sort of going, well, as a going to the cinema experience, that was too long. And now you're telling me I've got to come back and spend 50 quid again to bring
Yeah.
everyone and get them all treats. It's just like, no, not good enough. Soz, lads.
Just to get a sense of closure. It's a
Yeah.
flashback to the Matrix trilogy. So,
Oh, don't mention that. Oh my
yeah.
gosh.
Tom, thank you very much for joining us on the show, and we hope to have you back talking about your podcast and when they revive Torchwood, then
Oh,
you're going to be
please.
front and center.
Yes, please. Thank you. Good. I hope Russell's listening.
And that was my conversation with Tom Price talking about his podcast, My Mate Bought a Toaster. Go and listen to that podcast, to his podcast, and let us know the weird things that you've bought while maybe drunk or at 3 a.m. in the morning, which is what I would do. 3 a.m. flicking through playing solitaire because I've just finished watching a TV show and I can't go to sleep. And I'm like, oh, I'm flicking through this. Let's see. Or an infomercial pops up. And then I'm like, yes, I'm going to buy a new Hoover. And then the next morning, completely forget what I've done. Don't do that. Obviously, you won't be fine. Right. So you've been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I want to thank you for taking your time to listen to our show. If you're listening to this portion, thank you very much. Because without you listening, it'll just be me ranting at producer Dave about some of the TV shows that I've liked to watch and I've hated. and annoyed me and whatnot. And producer Dave would feel, what's the point of all of it? I don't get paid for this, so it's okay. And thank you very much to Resonance FM, as I always say, for not listening to our show. Otherwise, if they did, they would take us off the air. So carry on not listening. For those of you who don't know about Resonance FM, go and check out their, you know, the massive amount of content. They are a great radio station that provide inspiration for a lot of creatives, whether it's music, whether it's theater, whether it's art. Go check it out. Go check out their website and support them, because they're an arts council project. Fantastic group of people. Go and check them out. You have been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I have been Marcus E. Acko.
I'm still producer Dave.
And thank you very much for listening.
And we will speak to you all next time.
Goodbye.
Bye.